Okay, today we will cover the chapter 12. I hope that we completely cover, finish this chapter 12 this week. So today and tomorrow we'll be in class and finishing all issues in chapter 12. This is chapter 12 contains some subjects relate to a beam of with general cross sections, and main topic is the moment of inertia, how to calculate the moment of inertia, and how to calculate the shear stress in symmetric beam and unsymmetric beam, and bending of unsymmetric and shear center. So it is mostly relate to a beam, but the concept of a beam is now needs to be extended not just to a structure on the beam, but also twisting moment as well. So review of moment curvature relation, what does it mean? Well, we have a beam like that, and in terms of a force, we can have a Fx and Fy and Fz, those are three forces. But forces we call a axial force, I will call F. But shear force is we use a V. It's the same force, but only difference is the directions. So this is the force. And now another term is the moment. We have also three directional moments. This is the twisting moment. Those are two moments, bending moment. So as I mentioned before, cross section can carry three directional forces, three directional moments. And for this moment Z will mainly cause this curvature Z. Okay, this curvature Z, and this moment Y is mainly cause this curvature Y, right? So let's say we have a beam and we have a moment, then this will have a curvature. This is the we call curvature. Curvature is defined as the when we have a curve, we have a center of a radius, and this is the radius, and inverse of R is the definition of a curvature. Because R get smaller, curvature will increase, right? So we better use the inverse of R, that is the curvature. Okay, so when we have a bending like that, and center of this R, this is the, when we have a moment Y, and we have a curvature Y, curvature Y is the simply one over R. I will call RY and RY. Okay? So this is clear. In beam theory, so far we just consider one plane, moment, and curvature. But now we can equally consider in the other direction, which is a Z, and we apply moment Z, and we have a curvature Z. Right, curvature. And now another one is that twisting moment. Twisting moment is quite different from bending, but in terms of a moment and curvature, pretty much the same. So twisting moment is like a twisting, where you can twist and it rotate, rate of rotate. So now question is that when we have a certain directional moment, and certain directional twisting moment, we need to combine them and extend the concept. So let's say in any cross-section, now we have a certain moment which has a certain angle in each direction. Just moment, a vector, rather than a certain direction. Okay, so this is the moment we apply, and we can also have a curvature, and curvature is also, let's say when we have a this and that combined, we can have a little different curvature. So this curvature also has a vector, and it has a concept. We can use a vector representations. So now this moment has these three components, and now this curvature has a three component. Again, previously we only consider this and this and this. This one is simply curvature X. So always we have a force and curvature, and this is what? Bending rigidity. Similar concept is F equal KX. We always have a spring, and we have a force, and we have a deformation. Very similar concept. Force and deformation is a rigidity, stiffness, spring constant, right? So these three equations now put into a matrix form. Now this first one, well, let's start with X, okay? X, let's use MX instead of a TX, okay? So MX, KX, now GJ is a twisting curvature. And MY, KY, this, right? But in this case, all zero, right? All zero. We can invert this 3x3 matrix, is redefined. So right-hand side, you apply the force, and the left-hand side, you have a deformation. This is the what you calculate using 3D beam. In 3D beam, you can apply any forces, right? Three component of force, three component moment, you can have a extension. Well, you don't get a direct strain, but you do have a displacement and angle and so on as a deformation, right? So the tool you are using, the 3D beam, is not just for the simulation, but the purpose of learning the tool is to help understand this flow and concept. Okay? Now, what we like to extend this concept is this guy. There's a two very important point is that, what if we have a non-zero term? Okay? What if we have a non-zero term? Somehow, non-zero term. What does it mean? We close eye, we apply bending like that, but deformation is something like that. Okay? When we had previously applied the bending and curvature is like that, always the moment direction and curvature direction is the same, right? My thumb, and like this, and deform like that. But when we apply the moment, but deformation is like that, it could happen, right? It could happen. And when we have a non-zero term. Non-zero term, you invert, you also have a non-zero term here. So what does it mean? Again, when we have a MX, we multiply, we could have a this, that, all three non-zero term, curvatures. That's what you calculate or simulate using 3D beam. When does it happen? Well, if the cross-section is a square, cross-section is a square or a circle, then this one I will call Y and Z, and Y and Z. These are all symmetric, right? These are all symmetric. Symmetric means the cross-section, okay? This one, cross-sections, is a symmetric. And symmetric, right? But some cross-section may not be symmetric, something like a triangle. What happened in this case is that, again, this term may not be zero. So whenever we have this kind of triangle and we apply load, and then the deformation will be in any direction depending on this cross-section geometry. Okay, that's the topic we want to cover. Okay? So moment curvature relation. Another topic we want to do is that, how do we calculate this IY and IZZ and IY? And how do we calculate this guy if there is a non-zero term? So that's the one topic we will cover. That is the what called moment of inertia. Moment of inertia. And moment of inertia is that usually it's a second order moment of inertia. Why second order moment of inertia? Why do we call second order of moment of inertia? Let's try to focus on these cross sections. Let's just try to focus on these cross-sections, arbitrary cross-sections, and may not be symmetric, can be any geometry, any cross-section, okay? Could be circle or rectangle, but any cross-sections like that. Now, this is a Y and this is Z and Y. And let's forget the beam theory. Let's just define the moment of inertia. So by definition, moment ZZ, IZZ, you can visualize definitions. IZZ is something like, a vertical and this, IZZ. So if you have a cross section here, the distance is this. So this cross, this IZZ, and the definition, the distance will be IZZ will be Y square DA. And similarly, this IYY is the distance Z square and DA, okay? So IYY is Y square and ZZ YY and Z. Now, another definition we can define is that IYZ. And this one, Y times Z and DA. So these cross sections, we can have Y and Z multiply and integrations. So simply, this is a mathematical definitions. Okay, simply mathematical definitions. So how do we evaluate this moment of inertia? Okay, how do we evaluate this moment of inertia? Okay, 핸드폰 다 집어넣고. How How do we calculate this moment of inertia? Well, we don't feel good with integration, but it's mathematical. It's not that difficult. Okay, not that difficult. And there are two important procedures to calculate this one. One is the parallel axis theorem. So this is the one important method to calculate this second order moment of inertia. And there is another one, is the, this is a second method, or second skill we need to have, we better have, is the coordinate transformation. So there will be a certain method. Okay, so again, to evaluate this moment of inertia, we can use two different very important procedures. It's one, parallel axis theorem, and second is the coordinate transform. The purpose of a parallel axis theorem is that, back to here, when we calculate this one with respect to this coordinate, we may have another coordinate and calculate this with a certain distance. How do we relate one coordinate with another coordinate? In other words, let's say we have a moment of inertia of this cross section with respect to this coordinate. Okay, this is our small y and small z. So we do have all iyy, zz, and yz. Now, I'm sorry, not that one, a small one, okay? Now, how do we calculate another iyy, this is a large capital, zz, and iyz, and with this respect, we have iyy, and zz, and iyz. What we know is that the distance to coordinate, this is yd, is a constant, and we have a coordinate and coordinate, so we have a distance and distance. So yz and zd, okay, that's the definitions. Again, calculate the moment of inertia about moving axis. Well, I will, there's a several mistake, y and z, and this is a small y and z. By definitions, with the, for example, izz, by definition, the y here is that from here to there. This is the large y, okay? This has to be small y. Sorry, this is a mistake. Small y. And now y square is that this is the small y and yd. So small y and yd, and put it here. And then just mathematical manipulations, and we have this term and twice of yd. Yd is a constant, no longer a variable. So with respect to this integration, it's a constant, so it's simply out of integration. So this ya, and yd square is a constant, we do have it. Okay? So we you can see we have a two, I mean three integration. What is this term? Huh? What is this? Yes, this is a just moment of inertia with respect to this coordinate, right? Okay, so this we can simply call izz. What is integration dA? Yes, it's simply A. So this term, no problem. This term, no problem. This is no problem, no problem. But what is this? Integration y dA. What is y? Y is this y, right? Integration y. And I hope you do know y dA is the yc, is the center of centroid coordinate and A. That is the definition of centroid. Which means that if this guy, this axis, right now it doesn't look like a passing through the centroid, but this axis is go into a centroid, and this term will be, this yc will be zero, right? Okay, so, I'm sorry, not yd. This term will disappear, right? This term disappear. So if z axis pass through the centroid, and this term will be zero. So simply, this is the result, and you can see that, for example, I will explain how, what's the application of this. We have a, we want to calculate I, this is a Z, so a Y, and then this is a Z. We want to calculate moment of inertia of these cross sections. And distance is, for example, H. Then how do we calculate this IZZ with respect to this one? Simply follow this equation. What is IZZ? IZZ is the this Y and Z. Why? Because this point now pass through centroid. So this is, for example, this is a H and this is a B. Then what is IZZ? You know, it's a very famous equations. Gosh. So this one, so this, if this one is the Y, I mean Z and Y, and this distance will be, say this is the H and this is a B, and this is coordinate the small, this is a large Y and large G, and this is a small Y and small Z. And what will be the this guy, IZZ? So this is the famous BH 3 and 12, right? And what is the ID? D will be this much distance. So simply we follow, A is simply B times H. So I is easy with respect to this one of this cross section. We can simply calculate very easily without performing all complicated integrations. That is the definition of parallel axis theorem. Parallel axis, this one, and that is the parallel. Okay, parallel axis theorem. Same story goes to this axis and. And another story is this one, integration of YZ, but to make the long story short, is the same thing. We just YD and ZD and A, okay? So this is a very famous or very useful result you can use to evaluate a moment of inertia with a certain axis. One of the very important application of this parallel axis theorem is that say we have a certain cross sections. Okay, we have a cross sections, and this is the for example, man. 지금 자동차 회사에서 복합 재료 카본 파이버로 제품을 만들려고 엄청나게 지금 막 하고 있어요. 지금 막 쌍용 자동차에서 설계해 달라고 지금 자꾸 연락이 오는 건데. 이게 어떻게 아예 끊는 거지? 어? 아, 여기 있나? 오케이. 쌍용 자동차뿐만 이번 주에도 월요일, 화요일, 수요일 현대자동차에 70명 엔지니어를 하루에 8시간 동안 지금 강의하고 와가지고 내가 지금 다리가 부들부들 떨려. 그래서 그만큼 지금 자동차 회사가 왜 뭐가 문제냐면은 경량화. 가볍게 하지 않으면 이제 살아남지 못하고 연료 효율이 안 나, 가벼워야 연료 효율이 좋아지죠. 연료 효율이 뭔가 이렇게 기준을 안 맞추면은 어떻게 해야 돼요? 벌금을 엄청 물어야 돼요. 그러니까 when you sell heavy vehicle, you have to pay. I mean the 쌍용이나 현대, they have to pay penalty. 그러니까 they are losing more money than making profit. So it's they have to, and especially for electric vehicle. 앞으로는 전부 전기 자동차로 가죠. 지금 얘기해도 다는 모르겠는데, 내가 쌍용차에서 전기 자동차를 만들려고 지금 막 하고 있는 중인데. 뭐 전기 그 쌍용뿐만 아니라 현대자동차 제네시스 알죠? 전부 다 복합 재료로 쫙 하려고 2019년도 지금 막 개발하고 있어요. 그래서 지금 엔지니어들을 자꾸 지금 강의하고 가르쳐 주고 있는데 왜 내가 해야 되냐? 연구한 교수가 없어요. 그 과거 10년간 전부 다 다른 토픽을 하다가 갑자기 이런 것들이 상용화되면서. 근데 우리 연구실은 다행스럽게 외국에서 계속 하다가 지금 이제 국내에서 이제 수요가 일어나가지고 국내에서 지금 하고 있는데 뭐 나 얘기가 아니라 앞으로 이 모든 구조물의 경량화는 아주 중요하고 구조물을 경량화하기 위해서는 뭐를 알아야 된다? 재료 역학을 알아야 돼. 농담이 아니다. 내가 어저께도 계속 강의한 게 뭐냐 현대자동차에 70명을 두고 월요일, 화요일, 수요일 해야 돼. 근데 내가 수요일 오늘 수업 때문에 빼먹었어요. 그래서 카이스트의 김성수 교수한테 제발 네가가 아니라 좀 녹화까지 되는데 아니 취소 우리 다 같은 교수가 합쳐서 산업체를 교육을 시켜줘야 돼요. 그래서 기술 개발을 막 해야 되는데 아이간 그 전문가가 지금 없어가지고 지금 상당히 큰 적이에요. 근데 현대자동차에서 가르쳐주면서 뭘 가르쳐줬냐? 뭘 것 같아요? 3D 빔. 오, 3D 빔 좋대요. 너무 어렵대. 어렵게 뭐가 어려워요? 여기다 넣고 이거 한번 하면 되는데. 하여간 그 근데 여러분들이 배운 거랑 뭐가 좀 다르냐? 여러분들은 그 라미네이트라고 해서 이거 적층하는 거 그냥 한 장만 했죠. 네? 네, 거기서는 이제 라미네이트에서 복합재료를 카본 0도, 90도, 뭐, 이렇게 막 싸니까 조금 이제 어려워지는데, 하여간 그렇게 해서, we design a structures, the member of the automotive part, liver. 어떻게 하면 성능 유지하고, 안 비싸고, 가볍게 만드냐가 자동차가 살아남느냐, 죽느냐의 기로예요. 그러면서 트렌드가 어떻게 갑니까? 오토노머스로 가요. 오토노머스와 전기자동차와 라이트웨이트 비클로 가요. 내가 전기자동차를, 그러니까 자동차를 뭐가 다가 아니라 자동차뿐만 아니라 보트, 요트, 뭐 자전거, 뭐 모든 움직이는 거는 다 그만큼 이 재료의 이노베이션이 일어나요. 재료에. 여러분들 우리 고체역학 배울 때 세 가지 컨셉이 뭐예요? 이퀼리브리움, 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 스트레스 스트레인, 디포메이션 컨디션이죠. 다 똑같은데 복합 재료는 뭐가 더 애드 된다? 바로 스티프니스예요. 스티프니스가 좀 복잡해요. 당기면 막 쉬어도 일어나고 해서 스트레스 스트레인. 스트레스 스트레인 관계식이 몇 바이 몇이에요? 66에 36이죠. 그 36개 텀이 전부 다 0이 아니에요. 여러분 그 대부분 다 0이었죠? 그래서 풀기 쉬웠죠. 손으로 뭐 쉽진 않았지만 하여간. 근데 이제 복합재료로 갈 때는 그게 어나이소트로피이기 때문에 그놈의 복잡, 그러니까 좀 난제로가 돼요. 컨셉은 똑같아요. 그래서 그걸 가지고, 얼마나 더 가볍게, 이 스틱하게. 그러니까 BMW나 막 이런 데는 벌써 다 시작을 했고, 토요타 시작했고, 전 세계를 다 시작했어요. 우리 현대자동차가 좀 늦었어요. 왜? 거기는 현대제철이라는 제철소 회사가 있어가지고, 우리는 스틸 계속 합시다 하다가 이제 항복하고, 복합재료 이제 들어가기로 했어요. 오케이. 근데 뭐, 현대자동차뿐만 아니라, 뭐, 기아, 그 다음에 상용, 뭐, 그 다음에, 다른 조만한 회사들도, 경량화, 자동차를 경량화하는 게 상당히 큰 관건이고요. 경량화하는 데 가장 큰그 요건이 뭐냐, 그러니까 설계 기준이 뭐냐, 어떻게 하느냐. 전부 다 우리 진짜 거짓말이 아니라 복합, 그러니까 재료역학을 그대로 쫓아가요. 어떤 힘을 받, 비미에 힘 받아서 얼마나 꺾이느냐. 지금 내가 얘기를 할게요. 지금 이러한 구조물이 있어요. 반면적이에요. 내가 이것이 끼다란 이런 구조물에 뭐 차의 밑받침이 딱돼 있어요. 어떤 하중이 딱 걸립니다. 이렇게 모멘트가 딱 걸렸다고 쳐요. 자, 이거를 어떻게 우리가 H와 B를 설계를 할 것이냐. 모멘트가 걸릴 때. 네. 이게 간단한 것 같아도 이러한 간단한 컨셉이 아주 복잡한 구조물을 설계하는데 커다란 방향을 잡아줘요. 이럴 때 우리가 모멘트 이퀄 EI 커비처니까 I가 어떻게 계산된다? 그냥 심플리 뭐 12분의 BH 삼성. 알죠? 오케이. So moment of inertia will be simply B is a width and H is a height and a third power. 맞죠? These equations actually comes from a y square. Sorry, this is the a z and y. So this one is a simply z square dA. If you manipulate, you will get this result. Now let's try to have exactly same, but let's divide them into half. Okay, and then make it apart, little bit far from each other, and calculate I. Same definitions. This one, for example, let's say what is a dA? dA is this guy, small area. What is a z? Z is this distance, right? Now, compare this one and that. You have A, but Z is much further than this, right? On the left-hand side. So this guy, obviously, this I is much bigger than left-hand side. That is the concept of what? I-beam. The purpose of an I-beam is the, let's say, cross-section. We increase the distance so that we increase a z farther from neutral axis, center. So this I-beam, as you know, been widely used in a structure under all bending. So on the left-hand side and right-hand side, material cost will be same, right? Material, because A on the left-hand side, I need to fix this. dA, and on the right-hand side, A will be the same, right? Will be the same, so material cost will be the same, but only the difference is the huge, larger moment of inertia, I, and which give us a big benefit. again, remember, please, moment equal EI curvature. If I is big, curvature will be very small. So very stiff. Okay, very stiff structures. And that is the how we increase the bending stiffness. And we can use the composite or with a very different angle, and that's the more advanced story. But fundamental concept all comes from this understanding of moment of inertia, and very important. Okay, so I like to emphasize why we are learning and how we apply this concept of a parallel axis theorem. So parallel axis theorem in this case, how do we calculate this guy? Well, we have this one, okay? We have this moment of inertia. Say this one is the half thickness, this is the B, and now this one we call, you can call A. So this one will be simply moment of inertia of this area will be 12 BH/2/3. That is the moment of inertia of this area, right? Plus, you remember this formula? You have a y scale, y times y distance scale times a. So H/2 × B, this is area, times what? A square. So this guy is really big. Why? Because of A distance. So this is the way we can increase the bend moment of inertia a lot, very effectively, without paying the money for the material cost. And of course, we have a top and bottom, we multiply two. And now, tomorrow I will assign a homework and using the 3D beam, and you can easily define this guy, right? You can define this guy and apply moment, and you will feel that how less deformation you will have. Okay? I mean, detailed derivation, and you can forget it. You can forget, oh, what is a scale and A? Don't worry. But importantly, understand the concept, why do we learn this subject? Detailed equation, you can always ask Google. Okay, but you need to understand, why do we need this concept? Now, second, another important procedures we can use is to calculate, use the coordinate transformation. Why do you need this? Well, let's say we have a cross-section like that, but now the bending moment is applied this way, applied that way. Huh? Then how do we calculate? We now twist your head and Y and Z. And how you calculate Z square dA of this cross section? Well, it's a mathematical definition is the same, but geometrically is no longer parallel to this axis. You have a twist, rotations. So to do so, we learn this skill. It's called coordinate transformation. Very useful, very useful. And there are Z. So original coordinate system is the Y and Z. And now we have a new coordinate system, large Y and large Z. Okay? And again, by definition, to calculate this 2D rotational axis, 우리 학생 보고 이걸 좀 만들었니 좀 two datum given This, okay. 기분 this. 기분이 뭐냐? Okay. 기분이 이것이 이제 기분이 된 거예요. Right? And then this is y and z is a new coordinate. So 기분 y and calculate this. Calculate with respect to this coordinate. Okay. So, for example, definition of IZZ is simply IZZ is the Y square. Now, there is a coordinate transformation. This is all we need to understand in derivation of this moment of inertia is the coordinate transform. We know this coordinate transformation, right? Y and Z and two different coordinates. And there is a theta. So all we need to do is just put into this mathematical definition. And we have a lengthy, some integration and cosine theta. You don't like it and I don't like it. So let's skip that. But more importantly, the result. Okay, the result. Now, pay attention to this final IYY, which you have to calculate, and ZZ and YZ. What was the given? Given was this guy. Sorry, this is all this guy. Okay, this was the given. Given means we do know, say, for example, we do know this one, right? Y and Z, if it is a B and H, we do know how you calculate that, right? So from me? Okay. Now, the point is that how do we calculate with respect to another coordinate, which is the Y and Z? For example, given again is YY is the what? YY is the right? IZZ is a 12, B third and H, right? It's just exchange. And IYZZ is simply zero. So, okay. So using this one, we can calculate that one. Again, that is a rotate by the theta. And cosine square, which using the identity, 1 plus cosine 2 theta, right? And sine, what is this? 1 minus cosine 2 theta. What is this? Sine? That's right. And then this is the one we use and then rearrange. Ah, looks familiar. You haven't seen this equation before, right? Where? Mohs circle. Yes, if you consider this one as a sigma xx, sigma yy, YY and XY and you know convert, it's exactly same. Why? How come stress transformation appear again in coordinate transform? Which I don't like it. How come it comes again? 이게 지겨워서 이게 나 배우고 싶지 않은 건데 또 나타났네. 바로 모서클이 바로 이거를 대신을 해주죠. 그렇죠? 왜 이게 여기서도 나타나고 저기서도 나타나고 스트레인 저기 나타나냐? Mathematically, they are all second order tensor. As long as the order of a tensor is remain the same, the transformation is always the same. Something like a vector, you do know the vector, vx, vy, vector transformation of the 항상 cosine theta, sine theta, cosine theta, minus sine theta, 이렇게 나타나죠. 항상 이렇게 나타나는 게 이 V가 could be a velocity, could be a force, could be anything, right? as long as they are vector, they always follow this coordinate transformation. Why? That is a first order tensor. Now, stress, strain, moment of inertia, and there are another physical quantity, many, many, they are all second order tensor. So they follow the same transformation rule. Okay, so that's why it's okay, perfectly okay, skip complicate mathematics. But we do know, this is from this. So, point is that you can use a moment, Mohr circle to calculate, transform. So you understand, what are the given? You have a moment of inertia, this coordinate. What you want to calculate? I want to calculate this moment of inertia with a certain axis, theta, right? I don't want to go again, but you do know that this is the figure doesn't look good, but you define and then you rotate by, this is a theta, you have a two theta, right? So you can go to a chapter on the Mohr circle, but we didn't cover Mohr circle in this semester, right? Mohr circle을 이번 학기 말고 언제든지 안 배웠던, 처음 들어본 사람 없어요. 내가 먼저 빨리 대답해야지. 없죠? 다 배웠어요. 근데 거의 다 잊어버렸어요. 다 잊어버려도 좋아요. 그러나 컨셉만 잊어버린, Mohr circle이라는 게 결국 이거에서 이거 할 때, 그렇게 이렇게 돼서 벡터처럼 이렇게 되는구나 라고만 이해하고 있으면 돼요. 근데 실제로 이제 쓰고 이퀘이션 가지고 계산할 때는 어떻게 한다? 방법은 이 Mohr circle, 그러니까 엑셀, 구글 가지고 언제든지 컨셉을 이해하면 되고요. 어디 있냐? 여기 1학기 게 어디 있나? 오케이. 어딨어? 오케이. 엑셀로 계산할 수 있어요. 당연히. 이론이기. 그리고 엑셀 미리 해놨어요. 엑셀 여러분들한테 나눠줄 거예요. 그게 여러분들 카톡 오늘 받았죠? 네. 그게 바로 이 엑셀 파일입니다. 아까 이전 수업을 하다가 여러분들한테 다 나눠준 거예요. 뭐냐? 여기는 S라고 써있는데 그냥 I라고만 이해해주면 돼요. 스트레스냐? 혹은 모멘텀 이너시아냐만 이해하면 돼요. 이렇게? So, let's enter the value. 만약에 1, 0, 0 하면은 Mohr circle이 오른쪽에 착착 그려지죠? 예? 이 그려지는 게 어떻게 그려졌는가? 보면은 별거 아니에요. 여기 보면은 이 이퀘이션이 뭐예요? 많이 봤던 거죠? 어디서 온 거예요? 바로 요 놈이에요. 에서 요 눌러보면 오른 거 이거네. 다 똑같은 걸 알 수가 있어요. 오케이? 그래서 이렇게 가지고 이 그림은 이거 가지고 그림을 그리는 거예요. 오케이. 그래서 여러분들이 100을 넣고 내가 20도 θ에 대해서 계산한다 그러면은 Mohr circle 방법을 치든 이걸 치든 해서 이게 값이 얻어지면 돼요. 알았죠? Okay, so this is the very useful tool, but importantly, you need to understand the concept. Why do you need this? Why? Well, to calculate the moment of inertia of the cross section with the rotating axis. So let's say we have a cross section and we have all moment of inertia with this. Now, parallel axis theorem gives us the method this way, right? We want to calculate moment of inertia, this one, and coordinate rotation is this one. Okay, so here we have a certain area with coordinate with centroid. Now we can calculate here, 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 everywhere, right? So this is very useful and very easy to follow. Okay, so now back to here. Okay, so again, what we learned today is about moment of inertia. Okay, moment of inertia. Why moment of inertia is important? Moment of inertia is all about a beam bending and curvatures, right? And this cross section may could be a lot different types. So that is what we covered. Okay. I like to give assign a homework due tomorrow. Why? Because there are so many students are sleeping in the class. 자, 어렵지 않아요. Here we have a certain I-beam. Understanding the concept of I-beam, as I explained, so useful, okay? So useful. And actually this chapter contains a lot of different advanced topic. And also we need to complete all this chapter by tomorrow. So I need your help. In other words, you need to practice this one, okay? Which we'll cover tomorrow. Now you define this beam and then we applied a force, okay? F. You can use the coordinate Y and Z. And now calculate shear flow. Shear flow. What is a shear flow? Do you remember the shear flow? Shear flow appears in the shaft, thin walled shaft under torsion, right? For example, you have a very thin and you have a torque T, the shear flow remains all same and T over, right? That was a shaft and under torsion. But this shear flow also exists in here. Under this guy, this a vertical force will generate shear flow, right? This shear flow and this concept and how to calculate is not easy task. But you can always use a 3D beam to calculate this one. Okay, so let's try to spend some time to calculate this, but you need to do yourself again. Since we have some time, I will use a 3D beam and try to calculate. But you do understand what we're trying to do? we have an I-beam, we have the force. See, let's say we have a clamp and shear force, then shear flow, I mean shear force, shear force will always same from here to there, right? See, when you have, okay, 여기다 다시 그릴게요. Force를 내가 이렇게 가해주면은 항상 어떻게 돼요? Force를 가하면은 어느 단면이든지 shear force가 있죠. 그 shear force가 uniform하죠. Right? Shear force will be uniform. Why? Well, you draw the free body diagram of this guy and this force, there will be reaction force. This reaction force will be always, internal force will be always the same, right? So the shear force will be the same and moment will be the maximum and moment will increase like that, right? Moment at the maximum and maximum moment will be F times L and decrease to zero. So this is very, very important. You don't have to calculate. You need to immediately come to these distributions. Anyhow, let's apply F and get the shear flow. How? Well, if you do calculate this shear flow, not easy. We have to do a lot of mathematics, VQ, IB, and so on. It's not easy, but we will cover tomorrow. But numerically, I hope you must know how to calculate and understand how they distribute. Okay, so let's go to a 3D beam and any tools. I'm not sure what is this, but let's use a simpler one. Okay. You do have old 3D beam, okay? Right? But 3D beam, as you can see, very useful. Useful means it can be very valuable tools. Well, in terms of money, they can be really expensive tool if I sell. So that means I'm not gonna ask you to pay, but don't distribute. Don't distribute. I could get paid. 한 수천만 원은 금방 받아요. 근데 여러분들의 그냥 나눠준 거예요. I'm just kidding. Okay, so let's define a material. I don't want to go through these definitions and laminate. Well, it's the same thing. You don't need to go through. But the main point is this section, how to define this I-beam. You will see how simple and how straightforward it is. Let's use any example, okay? And I will just move copy and paste, and you can say this is a create copy. I explained to you, right? You can have your own worksheets, and you can say this is the what? I-beam. Now, to define the I-beam, let's try to have a coordinate system. I-beam, like that, this, and that. Now, to define this one, we better use line generation because we're going to use this line, right? So to define this line, what do we need? We need to define a key point, this key point that 1, 2, 3 and 4, 5, 6 key points. always when we generate geometry, we start with a point, line, area, and volume. That's the geometrical concept. So let's say, let's put the coordinates at the center, and let's define this is the, what? This is the H, okay? And this is the what? And B. And also each one, let's have a thickness, we don't have to worry because we can define the laminate, right? So we define only line. And what else? Well, I guess that's the one. So one, number one, what's the coordinate? Coordinate, this is Y and Z, and coordinate is the minus half B and minus half H. That's the coordinate of number one, is it? Okay, so you can have your own variable, so let's call H. Anywhere, H, just H is not enough. So H is C and B, C. And you can start with any numbers. And you can have a very defined, right? Now, number one is that, what is the number one? Is equal minus B, this guy, divide by 2. Oops, sorry. This one. Not X. Has to be Y. Right? And Z is what? This H. Right? Okay? And what is the 2? Number 2. Number 2 is here, and what will be the coordinate system? Right, Y equal 0, and Z equal same. And what is a coordinate 3? Very simple, X equal 0, Y equal just plus, right? Plus and this. And now, and 4, 5, 6 will be exactly same as this guy, but the only difference will be Z equal positive. Right? Okay, so we got all key points as needed. And now let's define a sector, meaning now we have this is the sector, this is a sector 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 5, where we can name as you like. And so one, let's say this one, only let's divide them into 4, and line generation is a 0, and option 1 is what? 0 is the key point 1, 2, right? 1, 2. What is the word here? 1 and 2. 1 and 2. And we don't need a Z. And now, what else? We just copy and paste and sector, let's call 2. Now, difference, this will be 2 and 3, right? So this is a 3 and 2 and 5, right? And another one, it will be 4, and 4 will be what? 4 and 5. And also, number 5 will be, number is a 5 and 6, right? Okay, before we learn, always save, let's say I bin. Okay, and then click generate. Man, why? Jom do kwansimul gajjeotgetjiman은 그걸 가져야 돼요. 아주 중요합니다. 이 버전 컨트롤, 메인테넌스가 디벨롭 하는 것보다 더 중요해요. 그래서 상당히 많이 이게 내가 버전에 뭐 고쳤다 쫙 이 히스토리가 없으면은 쫓아가지 못해요. 근데 일단은 뭐야 지금 다른 쉐어하기가 좀 힘들고 어쨌든 이거 여기 이름에 빈칸이 있으면은 안 되네. 나도 오늘 처음 알았네. 자, 어쨌든 여기에서 아까 이거 클릭을 하면은 그러니까 number of division은 4가 되든 10이 되든 사실 상관이 없어요. 그래서 4니까 뭐가 된 겁니까? 이게 하나 둘 셋 넷 각 네 개로 끊어진 거죠? 예. 네, 그래서 문양 됐고 그다음에 중요한 건 이제 thickness인데 스틸이라는 라면의 데이터베이스 스틸의 두께가 이렇게 된다는 건 알고 있죠? 요게 thickness입니다. 각 요거를. 그래서 여러분들이 뭐 thickness를 좀 두껍게 하고 싶다. 이걸 넣어주면 되고, 여기다가 뭐 스틸 말고 뭐 알루미늄 넣고 뭐 적중을 해도 좋아요. Okay. So all is done. And then now let's define the geometry. Geometry를 우리가 아직 안 했죠. 그럴 때 항상 auto로 가서 여기다가 111 하고 그냥 number of division 이렇게 하고 a generate를 반드시 한번 거쳐서 해서 node하고 numbering 한번 다시 confirm 하고요. 그 다음에 you can close it and you can go back to and then you can see 10 and 11 has renewed and load you apply the load and this is a old clamp and now let's say we apply y and z and 3 and this is the 1 and this is a 0 and okay so and always don't go 그냥 이렇게 클릭하지 말고 항상 이 버튼을 눌러서 가야 데이터가 쭉 업데이트 됩니다. And then let's 가만있어 봐. 크로스섹션이 이게 좀 되게 아까 우리 크로스섹션이 얼마였죠? 1이었죠? 길이는 아까 우리 얼마였지? 10이었나? 아, 그럼 뭐 어느 정도 됐겠네요. 자, 그래서 계산합시다. So what I'm trying to emphasize is that how do we get shear flow? Shear flow 도대체 뭐를 봐야 shear flow인지 that is the one I want to emphasize and show you. 그래서 여러분들이 뭐 지금 다 했지만은 좀 더 try do yourself. Okay, try yourself and change this that you have a height, right? Your height를 아까 내가 어떻게 했어요? We define a variable h and b, right? So whenever you use the Excel rather than just number, always try to define a variable and change those value of that variable. So h를 한번 해보고 밴딩을 한번 해보면, 오, 이게 H가 이게 얇아지면, 오, 이게 엄청나게 변형이 준다, 커진다라는 것을 알 수가 있을 거예요. 그래서 그런 것들, 그 다음에 지금 보이려고 하는 이 shear flow. 그러니까 지금 왼쪽이 어떻게 됐어요? clamped 됐죠? right? clamped. 그 다음에 우리가 이렇게 쭉 올렸어요. 그러니까 당연히 지금 with respect to a undeformed shape, 그러니까 undeformed shape이죠, 덧덧덧이. And then you see the deformed shape. Now, this is a clear, and how much you get? 5.99. 이것도 한번 계산해 볼 수 있겠죠. 쉽게. 그 다음에 여기 post data 가서 보면은 n1이 있고요. 자, 이게 우리가 보고 싶은 여기 내가 두 개가 있는데요. 플러스 가 있고 마이너스 가 있고 오케이. 그래서 이게 그 쉬어 플로우입니다. 쉬어 플로우 잘 보세요. 네? 잘 보세요. 아 이게 무슨 색깔이 뭐 대칭도 아니고 뭐 이상하게 됐네라고 하는데 바로 이게 쉬어 플로우인데 쉬어 플로우인데 오케이. 쉬어 플로우보다 이거를 한번 보세요. N1. N1이 뭐라고 그랬어요? 우리가 이게 시그마 스트레스라고 그랬죠. 그러니까 위에가 어때요? 압축이죠. 여기는 인장이고 이게 잡아당기는 거죠. 누르는 거고. 그래서 여기가 어때요? 모멘트가 제일 크죠. 그러니까 이렇게 되는 거는 이해되죠? 쉽게? 예. 네, 그리고 보세요. 이게 여기서부터 쭉 변화하죠. 왜? 모멘트가 아까 얘기했지만은 maximum and zero니까. 맞죠? 자, 중요한 게 shear force입니다. shear force를 보면은 여기 N6 이거 뒤에 신경 쓰지 말고 N6를 보면은 가지 값은 모르지만 어때요? 전부 다 똑같죠? 여기 다 똑같죠? 다 똑같습니다. 똑같은 거 확인했어요. 왜? shear force가 다 똑같기 때문에. 자, 그 다음에 이 값들이 뭐냐를 지금 내가 얘기를 해야 돼, 하고 싶은데. 시어 포스가 왜 똑같을까? 그게 여러분들한테 지금 이 탐 생각을 해보라고 하는 겁니다. 자, 이거 보면은요. 어땠어요? 이 cross sections carries 이 force가 들어가는 거 아까 우리가 얼마 줬어요? 얼마 줬죠? 얼마 줬어요? Now the shear stress I will try to redraw here. Shear stress what we shear stress is that 결론부터 얘기할게요. Shear flow가 이렇게 이게 점 이렇게 늘어나요. 잘 보십시오. 이렇게 된 다음에 여기서 쭉 제일 커지고 적어지고 그 다음에 이게 다시 이리 가서 점점 해서 빵으로 가요. 바로 이런 그림이에요. 내가 여기다 그래프를 그리면 이게 직선으로 갔다가 이게 이렇게 갔다가 이렇게 떨어지는 꼴이에요. 자, 여기 보면은, 여기가 얼마인가요? 요 끝에가 초록색, 파란색이니까 거의 요 부분이죠? 맞나요? 잘 안 보이죠? 예, 네, 잘 안 보여요. 근데 거기가 거의 0이에요. Okay? I will try to magnify again. But this is very important to understand the shear flow. 그래서 여기 보면은 요 부분 이 조금 파란색 부분이 이 부분이죠. 자, 여기하고 여기 부분이죠. 그러니까 0인 거 알겠죠? 0에서 조그맣게 0에서 시작했죠. 자, 점점 이쪽으로 가면 어떻게 되나 보세요. 점점 늘어났죠. 이게 선형으로 늘어난 걸 우리가 보기가 힘들지만 뭔가 이렇게 늘어났죠. 그 다음에 여기서도 역시 마찬가지로 파란색에서 점점 이리 갔죠. 왜? 그럼 부호가 어디로 갔어요? 마이너스로 갔죠? 그러니까 이놈이 이렇게 갔는데 이거는 반대로 지금 가고 있다는 얘기예요. 절대값은 똑같아요. 예? 그러니까 이게 지금 이렇게 가고 있고요. 이게 지금 이렇게 가고 있다는 거예요. 서로 방향이 이렇게 가는 거예요. 자, 그 다음에 여 부분은 어떤가 봐요? 여 부분은 어디 부분이에요? 이 부분이죠? 빨간색하고 제일 큰 놈이 어디예요? 색깔이 조금 비슷하지만은 주황색 여기는 빨간색이죠? 빨간색이 맨 위에요. 그러니까 여기가 제일 크게 걸려요. 그 다음에 여기서는 이렇게 된다는 걸 우리가 알 수 있어요. 쉽진 않지만 하여간 그래요. 그 다음에 밑에서 보면 다시 또 이렇게 된다는 거예요. 그러니까 이쪽이 이렇게 됐는데 이쪽이 어떻게 돼요? 이렇게 되는 게 지금 부호가 같은 걸 알죠? 그래서 이쪽하고 이쪽이 지금 색깔이 같이 파란색이죠? 그러니까 이쪽이 이쪽이 지금 다르다는 거는 같다는 거는 이게 방향이 이렇게 된다는 거예요. 그래서 내가 쭉 밀면은 시어 플로어가 이렇게 어디가 최대? 중앙이. 이게 밴딩은 어디가 최대? 맨 위하고 아래. 그렇죠? 시어는 어디가 최대? 항상 중앙에서 최대. 잊지 마세요. 이게 그림을 쫙 보기는 연상하기 힘들지만은 색깔이 그런 의미를 나타내고 있어요. 네? 아주 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 중요한 그림이고 이 계산을 우리가 수식으로 할 줄 알아야 되겠어요. 그거를 우리가 여기나 저기나 이제 그 내용이 이제 나오는 겁니다. 오케이. 질문. 조금 시간이 지났는데. 네, 질문 뭐
과제.
아, 과제. 오케이. 과제는 내일까지 여러분들이 그룹끼리 모여서 얘기하고 지금처럼 풀어보고 그다음에 여기서 어떻게 해요? 두께를 높이를 한번 줄여보세요. 딴 거 말고 높이를 한번 줄여보세요. 그러면서 한번 아 이렇게 되니까 이렇게 되냐고 느껴보세요. 예? 과제는 제출할 필요는 없어요. 예? 그렇다고 안 하면 안 돼요.
네.
예, 내일 봅시다.
감사합니다.